The world has become wireless during the past 20 years. Now we people are connected everywhere. But this development will now continue and next our things will get connected. Antennas enable all this development. Why antennas are different, are important? My Danish colleague has studied antenna performances between different mobile phone models. And this table lists sensitivities of two phones, Microsoft Lumia 640 and HTC 10. For example, if we take 800 MHz band shown here, we see that Lumia 640 provides 8.2 decibels higher sensitivity, mostly because of the antenna. This is quite a lot because we are talking about decibels, which is a logarithmic scale. This means that theoretically, Lumia can provide 2.7 times faster data rate, or it can provide 6.3 times lower consumption of radio frequency power, or 2.5 times larger connection range than HTC 10. So a good antenna really makes a difference, huge difference. I have three main research topics. First one is antennas for mobile devices. Second, antennas for mobile communications networks. And third one is are devices that are powered by ambient radio waves around us. Because this talk is so short, I will give you only three research examples on antennas for mobile devices. So first I tell you about antennas for metal covered foam, then I introduce a frequency tunable antenna, and finally I present a completely novel topic that we published just a couple of months back here, digitally tunable antenna. Nowadays many phones have metallic back cover, and phone designers would like this back cover to be fully metallized because of visual appearance and robustness. But metallic back cover makes the phone kind of Faraday cage, and no radiation can come out from this structure easily. And therefore, all manufacturers now need to make these kind of slots on this metal cover to help antenna operation. Sometimes this cover is hidden visually, but it's always there. So we have just recently developed antenna solution for this kind of fully metallized phone, and I'm not aware of any other feasible antenna solution for this yet. This shows our electromagnetic simulation model for fairly generic phone shown here. Here, golden parts are metal and blue parts plastic. Now, bottom of this model is fully metallized and the display will come on top of it. And now this is kind of a simplified model that contains all the necessary information for us to simulate how this device radiates. We place antennas on this outer metal rim surrounding the phone. And in a typical mobile phone, we need to have many antennas, which are listed here. We need to have two cellular antennas covering two different frequency bands, both. Then we need to have one antenna for GPS and two antennas for Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, covering also two different frequency bands.
some of these antennas can be combined together if needed. So altogether five antennas. Okay. This shows, the white figure here shows how we placed the antennas. So we have made these kind of vertical slots on this metal rim surrounding the phone. And we have numbered antenna elements. We have here 8 elements all together. This structure we simulate in an electromagnetic simulator to know how well these elements radiate. And this is now very, very common in all mobile antenna designing, that these antenna elements are extremely small compared to wavelength. And therefore, they are highly reactive, meaning that if we feed energy in one element, element does not accept it easily because of this high reactance, and majority of the energy reflects back. In addition, these elements are really close to each other and they share the same small device. So energy couples from one element to another. And that is something that worsens the antenna performance a lot. And therefore, we can never make good antenna only by shaping these elements. So therefore, we add reactive loading to every element. We call this matching and decoupling circuitry. And in this case, the circuitry is shown here. So we need to load every element with this kind of circuits consisting of reactances by capacitances and inductances. And this side we must simulate in a circuit simulator, which is different from electromagnetic simulator. Well, what's so problematic? We have a huge amount of freedom on both sides. So on this side, we can select positions for these antenna elements. We can tune their shape and size. And we can change the number of the elements. And also feed position is fairly significant thing. Here on the circuit side, we can tune the number of these circuit elements. We can vary circuit topologies. And then we can also vary the actual component values. So we have huge amount of freedom on both sides. And ideally, we should optimize everything to work efficiently together. But both these sub-optimization problems are already alone highly nonlinear, and it's almost impossible to use any gradient search method or anything, any local optimization method. So what we typically do is that an educated antenna designer who understands a lot about electromagnetism and circuits makes educated guesses, for instance, first here, then he optimizes this kind of circuitry for that given antenna, then goes back to electromagnetic side and iterates until a sufficient solution is found. Often it is not found and that search must be started over. Okay, in this case we managed to get good solution, and this slide shows simulated efficiencies of all our antennas. So here we have cellular low band, cellular high band, GPS, low band Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. And efficiency is in this design between 30% and 50%, which is fairly good for this kind of antenna and sufficient. But this slide shows one really fundamental problem. then we used fixed matching networks that I just showed you. So we can make with fixed matching networks antennas highly efficient radiators at one particular frequency, or we can make them broadband, in which case they become highly inefficient. So for instance, this GPS antenna is really efficient because the band is so narrow. So efficiency is close to 80% or 90%. But if we want to have a larger band, efficiency drops dramatically. That's a trade-off we almost must make. And that, then we, I can go to my second topic, because we can avoid this kind of trade-off if we use tunable matching network. Again, this shows a simulation model of one phone with two antennas on it, one in blue, the other in red. Both antennas are loaded with matching networks, shown here. And these matching networks in this case looks like this. So we have one parallel inductor, parallel capacitance, series inductance. This is fairly typical, except that one of these capacitors is tunable, which means that we can change its capacitance value. And this is how we can also change the operation frequency of that antenna. So we can make it both efficient radiator and cover relatively large band. This figure, or this blue curve, shows the reflection coefficient of one such antenna. And reflection coefficient dips here. It's small, which means that efficiency is high because almost all the energy radiates. It doesn't reflect back. And now this antenna covers one frequency around 700 megahertz. And you can see that this frequency range is really narrow. So it's efficient but narrow. But because we have this tunable capacitor, we can change the operation frequency like this by changing the capacitance values. So that kind of solves a bit the original problem. But still, this is not perfect, because we can operate at many frequencies, but only at one frequency at a time. So our instantaneous band is still narrow. And in future, we need to use really large bandwidths to get high data rate. So this is not perfect solution for future devices. And let's then go to the third topic, which is digitally tunable antenna. So as I told, this was just presented a couple of months ago. And in this concept, we can digitally tune the antenna without any physical matching elements. I tell you how. So for simplicity, let us consider this kind of a group or cluster of four simple monopole antennas on top of this metallic ground plane. Now, let us feed one of these monopoles with a wave. So we input wave to this monopole, but again, this monopole is relatively short and highly reactive. So majority of the wave reflects back. In addition, these monopoles are close to each other and they couple to each other strongly. And therefore, when we feed one monopole, others capture part of that signal that we fed into one. This is generally considered really bad thing, because in general approach, we lose all this power that is received by other antenna elements, but we are going to utilize it in a smart way. And finally, of course, really small portion of the original energy radiates. Okay, let's continue. Let's add a feed signal to this second monopole, like this. Again, the same happens. Part of the energy reflects back, and part of it couples to other monopoles, and small portion radiates again. And we can continue. We add a feed signal into every single monopole element. And as a consequence, we have four reflected waves in every antenna and four radiated waves. Now, if we selected feed signals properly in every port, it's possible that these waves, in these reflected waves in every port, cancels each other in the same way that noise cancelling microphones work. And in that case, there's no reflection at all in any port, and radiated waves here kind of add constructively together and amplify each other. And finally, all the energy is radiated into free space. And this way, we were able to tune the operation frequency of the antenna without any physical matching components, simply by changing the amplitudes and phases of the signals that we fed into different antenna elements. This figure again shows the total reflected power from the whole antenna cluster in blue as a function of operation frequency. Now we tune the operation frequency by changing the feed signals. Initially, antenna is tuned to operate somewhere around 1.5 GHz, and let's see how the operation frequency changes when we change the feed signals. So now this operation frequency shifts upwards. Okay, this is great. We can cover a huge frequency range from about 1.5 GHz up to 8 GHz with this simple antenna, and most likely we can go even higher than that. And of course, now it looks that still we have a small instantaneous band. But this is the case only when we have feed signals at one frequency, or we weight signal with one weights. But if we want to transmit a signal that consists of many frequency components, we can weight every frequency components differently at the same time, and our instantaneous band is really as wide as this. We can cover this instantaneously, all this. So this is much more broadband than any other tunable antenna. And if we compare this to a traditional approach, which is shown here, so in traditional radio, we have a transceiver in an integrated circuit. Then we have external matching components, shown here. These are analog components, inductors, capacitors, and some tunable elements, such as this switch over here. Then we have different antennas tuned to operate at different frequencies. In this new concept, instead of this external matching network, we only need to have many transceiver chains in the integrated circuit, which is like digital integrated circuit. So we have kind of moved the complexity of this analog network fully to this digital integrated circuit, and that's why we call this concept digitally tunable antenna. Benefits are that because we don't have matching network, we don't have losses associated to them. We don't need space for these components. they can still be relatively large components. And I believe this new approach is less complex. And the best thing, it provides huge instantaneous band. And I believe it makes also antenna designing simpler, because we don't need to co-design these two. We can only concentrate on the antenna itself. And I would like to conclude my presentation telling that, reminding that antennas are everywhere, and they are one of the most important parts in wireless communications. And they become all the time smarter and smarter, but also more and more complex. And before I finish, I noticed that I'm the only bastard who don't have an acknowledgement slide here. And I didn't do everything myself, I must say. And I'm not sure if I did anything at all. But yes, so I would like to acknowledge all my colleagues that have contributed to this. So thanks a lot.